during the lecture sessions. If you have any doubts or any questions, please drop your question into the chat box. After the lecture session, we have an interaction session. So today we have Professor Madam Swarnamayi Tripathi, head of the Department of Public Administration, Utkal University. Madam has a vast experience in public administration as well as political science. Today, Madam will discuss about a topic on decentralized development on empowerment. So I would like to invite Professor Swarnamayi Madam to take the session. Madam, please.
So good morning, students, participants. So today's topic is decentralized development, and the first component of is empowerment. This is your fifth unit. Now, I do not know whether you have read the first four units or not. Without discussing about the first four units, we cannot have a discussion on the fifth unit. But however, we cannot focus much on the first four units. Now, I would like to address one request of you learners in the last class, that you said that I mean, since I was talking in English, it was difficult for you to grasp the things. What I feel is that I would continue to talk in English, because when you later on hear the video, it will be of lasting help to you, but I will be very slow so that you catch up each and every point perfectly. Now, it's a very, very important topic, and I am actually privileged that I have been given this topic, because understanding of the topic of empowerment, or the concept of empowerment, is itself empowering your own self. You feel that you are strengthened, you feel that you have more self-confidence, and you feel that you have learned how to improve your self-image. Now, I have prepared a small PPT, which I would share with you all. Now, in this decentralized development, the background we will discuss about the concept of democratic decentralization, the contextual dimension.
Ha, madam.
Yes.
Eta subha jauchi, but actually problem hochi PPT ta dekha jauni madam, present ta hai ni bodhe.
Dekha jauni.
Yes, yes.
So what will I do? What will I do?
Madam, tole jo present now option ta achi. Dekhu click karantu.
Kali.
Yes, yes.
এবে দেখা গেল?
Yes, yes, madam. দেখা গেল.
Okay. So before we discuss about the concept of empowerment as a component of decentralized development, what I would like to say that you need to understand in what context we are discussing this topic. Now, the concept of democratic decentralization is actually a strategy of Indian state to empower the people at the grassroots level. Now, what is this decentralization? Acha nishanto eta dhadak kai hochi
kota madam
ei jo screen ta anti blink kai karuchi dhadak hochi kai ki
ସେଟା ଟିକେ ମ୍ୟାଡମ୍ ଇଣ୍ଟରନେଟ୍ ପ୍ରୋବ୍ଲେମ୍ ରହୁଥିବ ବୋଧେ, ସେଥିପାଇଁ ଟିକେ ପ୍ରୋବ୍ଲେମ୍ ଦଉଥିବ ବୋଧେ।
So what let me tell you one thing, we need to understand decentralization in the context of development and democracy. Now you see, first after the independence we thought of introducing development in our country, and we were very much fascinated by the Western model of development, which was a linear model of development. That means from agricultural economy we will move towards an industrial economy, and industrialization will bring urbanization, and urbanization will result in changes in our attitude towards looking at life, looking at development, looking at self development. So this is called as the Western model of development. Now the Western model of development has an institutional framework, that is the liberal democratic state. Now the liberal democratic state is based on the strategy that everybody must have political rights, every adult citizen must participate in governance in the form of enjoying political rights like casting their vote. This is how we understood democracy, and in the process we thought we should continue with our indigenous governance mechanisms, like Panchayati Raj was our indigenous governance mechanism, and the British Indian administration had introduced urban governance to have a better city life. So when after independence we decided to adopt democracy as one of our ideologies, then we ensured democratic decentralization as its institutional framework. That means we went a step further, and we ensured, we thought that democratic decentralization is the main kingpin of federal state. So we must devolve powers to the people. In the process, we wanted to involve people in the process of development through community development program in 1952, National Extension Service in 1953, and also democratic elections after we became independent. Now this is how we thought that we have ensured the institutional framework for a liberal democratic state. In 1957, just to have a overview of the community development program, that why is it not giving us proper results, we instituted a committee that is called Balwant Ray Mehta committee to have a critical examination of the community development programs. But however, the Balwant Ray Mehta committee, I mean the state, the Indian state owes a lot to the Panchayati Raj Minister, the Balwant Ray Mehta, and he said that what is lacking is a proper grassroots democracy in our country. We need an institutional framework to ensure democratic decentralization. And this is how we established the Panchayati Raj institution, the three-tier Panchayati Raj institution in 1959, and also in urban areas. It is not, you know, in a different form actually. And we decided that we have actually done a right thing. We have, in true sense of the term, we have established procedural as well as substantive democracy. Now, what is this difference? What is this procedural democracy and substantive democracy? Now, procedural democracy is when you enjoy political rights in pen and paper, in the constitution, in the Right to Representation Act, but in true sense of the term, the people are not represented. So that is how you see you face a problem that people do not get the power properly in a substantive sense. So then we decided that we must adopt decentralization as an ideology and the local self-governing institutions as its institutional framework. Now, the point is that what is this decentralization, this what type of decentralization is this local self-government? Is it administrative decentralization? Is this political decentralization? Is it only functional decentralization? What it is exactly? Is it centripetal? It is centrifugal? What exactly as it is? You know, I must tell you that decentralization literally means away from the center, decentering. That means the field-level organizations will have autonomy. So in the process, you know, what happens is that many a times we think that this is administrative decentralization. Now, what is this administrative decentralization? In public administration, this is called as delegation. Now, many critics say that the way the local bodies enjoy power, it is actually, it is not decentralization, it is not devolution of power, rather it is only delegation. That means it's only transfer of responsibilities, transfer of authority constitutionally, but no transfer of power. That is why, you know, let me tell you what exactly is this delegation is. You know, delegation is a concession given to the field level organizations to ensure administrative efficiency. Here, only the administrative personnel are involved, and they help in associated planning. It is an administrative strategy. In contrast to this, decentralization is a political strategy. It's a democratic strategy. It's an ideology where all people are involved. People enjoy this decentralized power as a matter of right, not as a matter of concession. It is wider than delegation. And if democratic decentralization is an ideology, then the institutional framework is local self-government. I must tell you here that decentralization is a post-modern framework. What is this post-modern framework? Now see, the modern framework, in order with an impatience in mind, decided to ensure development, in a very rapid way. We wanted to have development in 20 years, what the Western countries achieved in 200 years. So it was just like we focused on economic development. We thought that if if there is, you know, if we thought that if there is growth in economy, the fruits of the growth will be equally distributed among people. People will get this benefit because we believed in the trickle-down theory. Trickle-down theory means, you know, if there is a, the water is coming from top and falling down, you know, the whole environment has a cooling effect. So that is what we believed. We believed that if there is more economic growth, then the whole society will get benefit out of it. So we believed in a welfare state. We introduced many welfare measures, thinking that people are beneficiaries, people are objects of administration, people are passive. The rulers know better what is required for the people. So this was the model of development in the initial years of independence, where, you know, for you can say a quarter of a century. You said till 1970, the beginning of 1970s, we believed in that. And in fact, when in towards the end of 1960s, when we had the people's uprising in Naxalbari in West Bengal, which today we call as Naxalite movement, we thought that it is just an anti-government move by the opposition. We never realized that this Naxalbari movement is a reflection of discontentment among the people against the way the governance is happening. So that is how you see the modern approach, which adopted a one-size-fits-all formula for the whole country, the whole state, it was questioned. And gradually, first is the Naxalbari movement, and in 1974, women participated in the Chipko movement, questioned the policy of the state, the environmental policy of the state in Uttarakhand, right now Uttarakhand, previously it was Uttar Pradesh, and they compelled the government to withdraw the decision to cut down trees in the sub-Himalayan region. And also we found that there is no regular elections to local self-governing bodies, and the local heads of local bodies are behaving just like area rulers. And also we found that the rulers belong to the upper caste. Male, the local bodies became the seat for the power of the upper caste, the power of the male in the society. So in 1975, when the government came out, you know, in 1979 actually, the committee was set up in 1975, and in 1979, when the committee came out with the report, and the report is, the title of the report is Towards Equality. It's a must reading for each and every social science student. And you know, in that report, we found that whatever development we had or we are having, it has not reached to the women. And also, there is a woman is oppressed in a male-dominated society. And if the woman is a tribal woman, if the woman is a lower caste woman, a disabled woman, or if the child is belonging to a C or ST or disabled group, then they are doubly marginalized. Then, you know, this concept of marginalization, social exclusion came into being. So there was a need for no transformation in the understanding of the concept of decentralization. That is what is there in your I think in the second unit. So the your second unit says that democratic decentralization is a postmodern framework. So what is this postmodernism? Postmodernism says that you need to understand every area in terms of its diversity, in terms of its heterogeneity. So you so what you find that the postmodern framework actually reflects the ecological approach to public administration, which says that no public policy is made in a vacuum. It takes into account the demands of all the systems in
सर मैडम का वॉइस आ सुनी
इंटरनेट अगर अब तो इंटरनेट के स्लो अच्छी वॉइस टा बजे आ सुनता है ना क्लियर अच्छी हेलो मैडम मैडम लेफ्ट ही वाले
प्रॉब्लम थी वो मैडम आउटर जॉइन कर दो थी आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल द लॉटर्स टिके वेट करों तो किसी नेटवर्क प्रॉब्लम पाए मैडम लेफ्ट है चुकी मैडम खूब शीघ्र जॉइन कर चुकी
सर आपण कंटिन्यू करों तो सर
हिमांशु सर हेलो हिमांशु सर Himanshu sir, am I audible?
You are audible.
Sir, kichi pai apan take over karantu.
No, I have to leave right now. I was actually typing because I have a class at 11:30 with Professor Patnaik. So I was trying, typing that. Sorry, madam, I am taking your leave. But what happened actually? Madam did a very good start. And she was about to tell you the meaning of delegation and how delegation is one form of decentralization, right? But what happened? And the bigness?
Yes, sir.
I think unity. Or one can teach unit 5 only when students knows about unit 4. So a sequence need to be maintained. So without teaching unit 4, somebody will start from unit 5, then it will have a very deep impact on teaching learning process. So try to maintain a chronology, right? That will be good actually.
ଜିନିଷ ସବୁ ନଜରରେ ରଖିବୁ ସାର୍ ଆଇ ରିକ୍ୱେଷ୍ଟ ଅଲ୍ ଦ ଲର୍ଣ୍ଣର୍ସ କିଛି ସମୟ ପାଇଁ ୱେଟ୍ କରନ୍ତୁ କି ବୈଷୟିକ ତ୍ରୁଟି ଯୋଗୁଁ ମ୍ୟାଡ଼ାମ୍ ଲେଫ୍ଟ ହୋଇଛନ୍ତି ଆମେ ଖୁବ୍ ଶୀଘ୍ର ମ୍ୟାଡ଼ାମ୍କୁ ଜଏନ୍ କରାଉଛୁ ନିଶାନ୍ତ ସାର୍ ଆମେ ଅଡିବଲ୍
Yes,
मैडम का
ऑडिबल ମୁଁ କଣ୍ଟାକ୍ଟ କରୁଛି ମ୍ୟାଡ଼ାମଙ୍କୁ, ଠିକ୍ ଅଛି।
हेलो सौमेंद्र सर, हेलो सौमेंद्र सर, आम ऑडिबल सौमेंद्र सर।
हेलो विघ्नेश्वर जी।
सर आपन टिके सब पे इंटरेक्शन करन तो।
हां हां नो प्रॉब्लम। एक्चुअली
आई एम
लिसनिंग टू मैम।
डियर लर्नर आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट डॉक्टर सौमेंद्र महांती from assistant professor Central University Rajasthan, he will take the session few times.
Yeah, I'll just add few things here, maybe we can start a discussion on that. I hope it is audible to all, because ma'am was telling about decentralization and how it started in India, and she was trying to discuss the concepts of decentralization, delegation, devolution. I hope you understand the differences between these.
Okay, madam asked you chanti.
Okay, ma'am can continue. Yeah,
okay. So okay students, there is little disruption. I think what I am saying you are able to grasp it. So now we'll start with, I was talking about democratic decentralization, that the postmodern concept. And the postmodern concept, I told you that it is polycentric. The postmodern framework is polycentric, in contrast to the monocentric institutional order. Means previously government was monopolizing in distributing services, in delivering services. Now many other institutional groups are involved in this, like the self-help groups. Now bottom line, like the plan is now made today from the district level. Focus on diversity, that means we now accept that every area has its own issues. And we also understand that by giving power of planning to the people, it will break the oligarchic interest. That means the interest of the few, those who were enjoying power. Autonomy or independence at every level, that means you are free to make your own choices and you have a political environment choice. That means you have the voice to say we can be a participant in your policy, can be a beneficiary in your policy, or I exit from your policy, I do not want, because your service is not proper. So decentralization, remember, is not a remedy, is not a panacea, but an ideology or strategy. Now that is how you see democratic decentralization was accepted as an ideology. And previously we just had you know sorry, the presentation is actually making great problem. So the previously we just had, you know, we in directive principles of state policy, Article 40 said that the states shall work to promote Panchayati Raj institutions in India. In Article 246, the state was empowered to create or to introduce democratic decentralization at the grassroots level. But however, we realized that these concepts like welfare, upliftment, development is not serving our purpose. In the beginning of 1980s, we said that we need to have integrated development. We need to have growth with social justice. So in every developmental public policy, we made spaces for women, scheduled caste, and scheduled tribes. We also created space for the marginalized to enjoy political power. But however, finally, in 1992, we realized that we are far behind substantive democracy. That means democracy has remained just as something of a procedural in nature, just in pen and paper. People are not able to enjoy democracy. So what is required is that democracy must be enjoyed by all in a substantive sense, in a real sense, not in a virtual sense. So what is happening is that in 1992, the Indian state or the parliament came out with the constitutional amendment that is called the 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment. The 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment act gave institutional status to the local bodies and ensured a democratic operational framework for these localities. Like in every 5 years, we must have a change in leadership. And also the most revolutionary thing about is that the 73rd amendment, it was based on a concept called empowerment. Now, what is this empowerment actually? All of you actually know today what empowerment is, because empowerment is a very, very popular term. Now, empowerment, basically, you must understand empowerment as a process, as a goal, as an approach to administration, and as a product, as a public policy. Now understand, in 1960s, the rightists and radicals, they said in true sense of the term, democracy is not there, because the people who are marginalized, they are not enjoying democracy. In 1970s, feminists also expressed the same voice. In 1990s, the donor agencies, they said, we do not have real democracy. We have only virtual democracy. We do not have real democracy. Therefore, we need to empower the people. Now, they said in welfare, we had only passive beneficiaries. It was only an institutional framework. People had no voice. In empowerment, in contrast, we wanted active beneficiaries. That means those who will be benefited by the public policy, those who are casting their vote, they must have their voice. Otherwise, there is no meaning of, there is no outcome of democracy. Now they said that empowerment means it is one type of making the individual, the group, the community at three levels. Making the individual, the group, and the community self-confident. You give such spaces to the people. Space means the social space, the social privilege, or you can say the social opportunity to feel that they are not powerless. Now, if you want to understand empowerment, you understand first the concept of power. Power means getting the work done by others, maybe through influence, maybe through coercion. Now, if you are getting done a work through coercion, that is exactly the political authority. Now, the state authority is very powerful. If we do not want a public policy, the state will say, no, you have no freedom, you have no power. You, since it is a policy made by the state, you have to follow it. This is the law. And if you do not follow it, then you are a lawbreaker. You will be punished by the state. Now, empowerment says there is nothing called coercion. You need to follow a persuasive policy by which the individual, the group, the community themselves, they will understand that it is in their benefit. It is not in the benefit of the state. It is not in the benefit of the government. It is in their benefit. So empowerment is just like igniting the inherent strength within you, making you feel that you have power, you have inherent power, you have internal strength, and you also have the potential to bring transformation in the society. Now, if you consider it as a goal, then it is very much spiritual. In the sense that the individual, the group, the community must understand that they are powerful. They have made a journey from powerlessness to power in the given institutional framework. They can raise their voice, they can have access to information, they can have access to resources, they can they can organize themselves, they can make the government accountable, and they can change the policy which affect their lives. So this is at the spiritual plane, this is a goal. Once a society has empowered individuals, then there is no educator is required for the people to assert their rights. Once the people assert their rights, then there is true democracy. The government can, a government official or a bureaucracy can never be non-functional or dysfunctional. Non-functional means callous, indifferent. Dysfunctional means a corrupted bureaucracy. So the people are having awareness, then they feel themselves as empowered. In this context, I will just take an example. Now see, the present crisis of lockdown, government went for a public policy, that is sudden lockdown. People could not move. Now the migrant workers, they could not come from one place to another. Now, how the 100 million migrant workers showed their protest against the state? they showed the protest against the state by walking down miles and miles, saying that you just cannot stop us from using our own organs. We will walk down 300 miles, 800 miles, if you do not give us transportation and communication. That means at a spiritual level, people said that, I am healthy and hearty, I can walk down. You know, this is one way of empowerment, that I have the freedom to take decisions. You cannot stop me from walking. You can stop me from acting. At a social level, what is empowerment? At the social level, there should be an institutional framework to give you substantive equality. That means women are at par with men, lower caste are at par with upper caste, minorities are at par with the majority. So it's a egalitarian society, egalitarian governance framework where the society is equal. At a economic level, what you find is that, am I audible?
Yes, madam, you are audible.
Okay. At the economic level, what we find is that every individual has a right to profession. Every community can take a collective economic action to improve their productivity. Every group, like the self-help groups, they can take economic decisions to enhance their financial status. So what you find is that if empowerment is a goal, we need to achieve it at the spiritual level, at the psychological level. You know, if the word spiritual is a little bit confusing, you can understand it as psychological. At an economic level, I will be more productive. I can have diverse professions. I can earn as many money as I can if I can work hard. But I should not opt for any antisocial economic activities like smuggling. Or at the political level, I need to be given the chance to express my voices. Because it is my life and I need to have freedom for that. So the theory social scientists, they said, if we are practicing empowerment as an approach, what is happening is that we'll, in true sense of the term, we will bring transformation in society, because the transformation is not imposed from top, but the transformation is coming from the bottom, because people from within want that. They should have freedom. They should have opportunities. Like you see, today the government will not force anyone to have a mobile phone. Public has understood that yes, expenditure over mobile phone is an essential expenditure. But however, right now the migrant workers' voices tell us that there are many in India who do not own a mobile phone. Now, if empowerment is a process, then it involves devolution of power, means every individual, every group, every community must have power to decision making that affect their lives. That means because they are responsible for their life choices and life situations. Now, life situations, life choices, that means the lifestyle means what we eat, how we wear, what type of house we have. These are all lifestyle. It depends on our economic situation. That means a boy belonging or a girl belonging to a poor family has a different life situation than a boy or a girl belonging to a rich family. So there, if the society is a just society, if each and every human being is empowered to take decisions, if opportunities are there, social, political and economic opportunities are there, then I can bring a transformation in my life situation. If I have awareness, if I am active beneficiary, not a passive beneficiary. If I have the power to influence public policy by raising my voice. So, and if I get the information before a public policy is made, I can express my voices and I can bring a change in the public policy. So this is how we talk about empowerment as an approach. Now you will be surprised to know, when the government made the National Education Policy in 1986, there they have mentioned about this concept of empowerment. Like they had said that empowerment means building a self-image, self-confidence, developing the ability to think critically, ensuring equal participation in the process of bringing social change, encouraging group action to bring social change, and providing the opportunities for economic independence. Now you see, these are the lines I am quoting from National Education Policy 1986. Since then, the Indian state is discussing, deliberating on empowerment and trying to ensure democracy in a substantive sense. Now in 1992, when we had the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, we thought that we created an institutional framework. We thought that we must create the social opportunity for everybody to share political power. That means now you understand empowerment means dismantling the traditional power structure, bringing a change in the distribution of power, enabling the marginalized groups in the society to enjoy political power and to participate in the associated planning process. And this is how you see the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act reserved seats, one-third seats for women, and also seats for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in proportion to their population, and also a periodic elections. It also gave us a state election commission to hold periodic elections. You'll be surprised to know, let me share with you, that in one of the panchayats, election was held after 29 years in 1995, when the first election was held after the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act. Now, this Constitutional Amendment Act inserted Part 9 into the Constitution of India, inserted Article 243 to the Constitution of India. All of you know that. So that means an institutional framework was created. So this is the product, you can say. Here you can see empowerment as a product. And you see that the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act also came out with a State Finance Commission. That means the State Finance Commission will decide about the transfer of resources, financial resources, from the state to the local bodies, as the Union Finance Commission is transferring resource, deciding about transfer of resources from the union to the states. The 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment also gave us another institution, that is the District Planning Committee. That means now the District Planning Committee will collect the plans of panchayats and municipalities, then a district plan will be created, and the district plan will be sent to the state. State Planning Board will discuss about it. Then a state plan will be created. The state plan will be sent to the previous planning commission. I'm talking about the previous institutional framework. Then it was sent to the planning commission, and the 5-year plan was prepared before the Niti Aayog was created. The 5-year plan was prepared for the whole country. Once the 5-year plan is prepared, then the process is centripetal, not centrifugal. That means every state is bound to follow the 5-year plan, the priorities in the 5-year plan. This was the scenario prior to the Niti Aayog. And accordingly, the Planning Commission also had the power of allocation of resources. Now come to the point. Now the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act had its, after the amendment was made functional, we had the first election in 1995. Now, what you find is that, let me tell you before I discuss about what was the scenario of the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, I would tell you one thing, that empowerment has three dimensions. Social empowerment, that means there will be equality. Economic empowerment, that means everybody will have the opportunity to have its own livelihood. And political empowerment, so the everybody will have a share in the decision-making process. So 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act was made to ensure the political dimension of empowerment. Self-help groups were promoted. Self-help group was also made a public policy since 1992. And self-help groups were promoted to empower women and marginalized. And this is, you can call as, it's a social process as well as an economic process. Now, self-help groups are meant for economic empowerment and to develop group cohesion, so that when there is need for any collective action, then the public at the grassroots level, they can organize themselves to have collective action, to have group initiatives, and they can make the public officials accountable. That means raising your voice individually against the state, then you become weaker. When you are raising your voice as a group, then your voice is stronger, more audible. So that is why the social and economic process of empowerment was visualized or envisioned. Now, economic empowerment had two dimensions: creating employment opportunities like wage employment, and creating self-employment opportunities, because we thought economic independence will ultimately result in social empowerment. You will be assertive in society, and economic and social empowerment will ultimately give you strength to make your voices heard. That is political empowerment. And its result today is quite visible. Self-help groups are taking off many responsibilities. Many of them are illiterates. Many of them are having little literacy or neo-literates, but they are managing the show quite perfectly. So what you find is that the 73rd and 74th constitutional amendment ultimately wanted to make political empowerment operational, and the encouragement or promotion of self-help groups aimed at making economic empowerment operational, and social empowerment will automatically come. Because once I have few bucks in a hand, I will be a little bit assertive because I have independence to discard your opinion and to have my opinion. Okay. So that is how the elections were held. Now, let me tell you one thing that now we will discuss. Is this empowerment process having positive outcomes or not? You know, it is a very well thought out process. In fact, today empowerment is an ideology. So whether it has certain positive outcomes or not. Now I will show you a little in the screen you can see how I have given you what empowerment as a process means, what empowerment as an approach means, and what empowerment as a goal means, and what empowerment as a product means. That means it's make the individual capable, skilled, and active. Now you see what happened in the 1992, what was the outcome of the 1992 constitutional amendments. The objectives of the amendment were to enable women and the marginalized to use the invited space given by the state to develop the created space on a sustainable basis. Now, I hope you can understand what is this invited space. Invited space means the state made institutional arrangements to invite those who are interested to enjoy political power. That is called invited space. So the constitutional amendment made provisions for 33% reservation for women and also scheduled caste and scheduled tribe in proportion to their population in different states to their political power. Now what you find is that the goal is that the marginalized will convert the invited space into a created space on a sustainable basis. That means we have reserved today, 20 states have reserved 50% of the state's seats in local bodies for women. That means, try to understand the public policy. 100% seats are reserved for 100% seats are available for women and the marginalized. Only 50% seats are available to male. That means that once they come out, they are elected from the reserve post, they have political education, they have awareness in subsequent elections. Through their government's capabilities, they can acquire the on-reserve posts. That means to convert the invited space into cleared space on a sustainable basis. It has been seen that in some panchayats, there are all women panchayats. At one point of time, a panchayat named Kalakaleshwar in Khurda district had all women panchayat. All members were women. Now you see, whether it is sustainable or not, that is most important. Let me show you the data here. See that data here. There are approximately 13.45 lakh elected women representatives, which constitute today 46.14% of total elected representatives. That means the amendment, the constitutional amendment, only ensures one-third reservation. Today, women have acquired 46.14% of total seats. See the development. Now you see, five states which have higher elected women representatives. Today, Jharkhand has 59.8% of representatives as women. Rajasthan has 58.29% of women representatives as women. Uttarakhand has 57.83% of women in local bodies. Chhattisgarh has 55.14%. Karnataka 53.40%. And Odisha has 53%. But because of the political approach of the BJP party, that today we have 58% of the sarpanchas are women. So just see the thing that you can just see how the in Odisha, when in 2012 the panchayat election was conducted, it was found that 4.65% of women sarpanch, 4.63% of female ward members got elected from unreserved seats. Now, from this you can just make out how there is some outcome, there is some positive outcome because of the operational aspect of the empowerment. Why is it that it is taking so long? Why is it that we are not able to get 100% result? What are the constraints? Now let me show you. So what you find is that here you have a number of problems which actually not allowing women or the marginalized to make themselves empowered. First bottleneck is that they are not sufficiently educated. They do not know what are their rights. Second is that they are not sufficiently aware. Government is having training programs for PRIs, but however, the people are not as a great development in Indian society today. We have a allow women to enjoy power. Women want to assert their power, but the male members in the family, for example, the father in law.
Hello.
Dear learner. Yes. Hello.
हाँ yes yes राव सर मैडम लैप्ट पर ये चंती मुँह देख कुछ दम कॉल करो ची.
Okay okay. हाँ
आसी कर दे आसी. Hello. मैडम आपण कर माइक टा को म्यूट अनम्यूट करन तो म्यूट ही जाई छी
हे गला हेला हेला
यस यस मैडम
इज इट ओके
यस यस इट्स ओके मैम
आई वुड लाइक टू शो वन अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग फाइंडिंग दैट आई वांट टू शो टू द स्टूडेंट्स. See, a tribal female sarpanch was stripped, that means Betamado, while unfurling national flag 15 August in 1998 in Rajasthan. In another case, a tribal woman Pradhan was stripped in a Gram Sabha meeting in Madhya Pradesh as she had not consulted the leader of the dominant caste before taking decision. A Dalit sarpanch was during a panchayat meeting. So this is how what you find is that how the social contradictions in our society is not allowing the marginalized to enjoy the empowerment process.
Hello.
For this, what is required is that the social aspect of empowerment has to be strengthened. The psychological aspect of empowerment has to be strengthened so that they can be more assertive and they can enjoy the power. They can share the political power in true sense of the term. Okay. So now you can ask me any questions you like. Today we had much disturbances.
Yes, no. Thank you, ma'am. You explained briefly the meaning of empowerment. The need for empowerment, and you explained various initiatives taken for the empowerment. Also, you are explain the analytical operational framework of empowerment. And amar learner bar ko request karibi ki jati semanankara kisi question achi semane semanankara mic ko unmute karantu ebam madam ko directly interaction karantu.
I hope I hope you all have understood what the total aspect of empowerment.
Madam, three four three charity question achi ma apanku read out kariki kahi dau chu. Then jab man interaction karibe direct apanku. Okay ma'am. Ma'am, what is procedural democracy and substantive democracy?
Okay.
See, then ma'am question
go.
देन मैम क्वेश्चन अच्छी सोमेंद्र महांति सारंकर इमिडिएटली आफ्टर द इंडिपेंडेंस नेहरू एंड अंबेडकर वर नॉट इन फेवर ऑफ डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन ड्यू टू इंक्लिनेशन टुवर्ड्स स्ट्रॉन्ग सेंट्रलाइज्ड प्लानिंग एंड फियर ऑफ पावर ग्रैबिंग बाय अपर कास्ट एट द ग्राउंड लेवल रेस्पेक्टली सो हाउ डिड दिस चेंज एट द लैटर स्टेज आई मीन हाउ डिड गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया मूव टुवर्ड्स द डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन एज एन अल्टरनेटिव मॉडल फॉर डेवलपमेंट.
Okay, let me explain the procedural democracy and the substantive democracy. Here, this procedural word actually I would here invoke the idea of John Rawls, which gave us the theory of justice idea. He said, if you want to strengthen a society, strengthen the weakest links in the society. For that, what is required is that you need to institutionalize the distribution of primary goods, and civil and political liberty is one of the primary good when we move from John Rawls to Amartya Sen. Now, unless and until decision making power is properly distributed in society, if that power is not shared properly by the people, then what happens is that the voices, the requirement of the people, those who are at the bottom of the pyramid, that is not heard, that is not visible. Democracy means, we say, without democracy, development is not possible. Because how can we have inclusive development? Development fails if we do not have inclusive development, means development, all round development of one and all in the society. Now, unless and until we have inclusive development, in true sense of that term, democracy is not there. Democracy will not be operational. Other way around, we are not giving chance to the marginalized to express their voices, how can we have proper development? We did not document their voices. How the voices will be, the concerns will be visible in public policy? So that is why democracy and development are interlinked concepts. And in between comes decentralization. That means, how will we know the voices of the marginalized unless and until we have bottom-up planning? Now, in true sense of the term, when I am casting my vote, I can make a reasoned choice if I have awareness regarding planning, regarding issues, regarding the opportunity to influence public policy. Political freedom does not mean only casting vote. Political freedom means at every point of time I should be able to influence public policy. That is called political freedom. Now, if there is substantive democracy, means real democracy, then right now we are having a virtual class. I cannot see you properly, you cannot see me properly. So it's a virtual class. Now, in true sense of the term, in a real democracy, that means in a substantive democracy, I can enjoy my power. If I become the sarpanch, maybe I am a woman, or maybe I belong to the lower caste, I must be able to exercise my power as per the constitutional provisions. No bottleneck in the society, no contradiction in the society should be there to hold me back from enjoying my power. That is called substantive democracy. So if in every 5 years we are having elections in the panchayats, means we have substantive democracy. What is required is that whoever becomes a representative must assert his or her right. Here I would like to share one incident which I came to know during our research. I had been to a panchayat. There we talked to the panchayat members. you know, as per the Gram Panchayat Act, the sarpanch is a male member, Gram Panchayat Act of Orissa. If the sarpanch is a male member, the Naib Sarpanch will be a female member. So the Naib Sarpanch was a lady. So I just asked her, where do you sit? She said that I'm sitting with the representatives. I said, why are you sitting this side of the table? You are supposed to sit that side of the table by the side of the sarpanch. Now, since today, many of the women elective representatives are very young, first timers. You know, that is the contradictions in our Indian society. They are given only one opportunity. They are first timers. So in a village, you know, there are many such patriarchal constraints. When after the election, she was told to sit by the side of the sarpanch, she felt a little bit hesitant and she did not sit there. Now she shared with us that today I feel that day I committed a mistake, because after that I feel like sitting there, because I now understand that is my place, but I am never asked to sit there. And with the fear of creating enmity, I am not expressing that is my seat. So this is the patriarchal constraint that a woman is facing in the village. Same is with the local representatives. So if we have substantive democracy, then these bottlenecks will not be there. Okay? I hope I'm able to clarify the point. Now, what is the second question?
Hello?
What is the second question?
Madam, yeah, this is Soumendra here.
Yes, what was the second question?
I was asking, like, Nehru and Ambedkar in the initial years after independence, they were against decentralization. They were in favor of centralization because they had concern, like Nehru was in favor of strong centralized planning, and Ambedkar had some fear of grabbing a power by the dominant castes and classes. So immediate decentralization would have meant that those zamindars or landlords or upper caste people will grab the power instead of the common people. So at what stage did it change and India move towards decentralization? In 92 or 93, how come we moved from that sort of perception to decentralization as a model for development?
Okay. Now, you see, I told you that, just give me 2 minutes, I have to plug my... Yes. Now you were saying whether we have been able to get rid of Ambedkar's fear, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Today, to some extent, there is distribution of power where we accommodate the voice of the marginalized. Here the Governance means delivering proper public services to the people. The other day, you see, I think yesterday itself, that means people have become, in true sense of the term, they have psychological empowerment. They have self-confidence. They have awareness that they can change the scenario. They will, the officials, let it be labor contractor, let it be the real estate agent, let it be the government. Everybody will become accountable to the people because it is a democracy. Democracy becomes non-functional when the citizens are not educated. Citizens are passive. Citizens are having fear in their mind. Now, empowerment in true sense of the term means that the citizen acting without fear in mind. When that situation will come, you know, in true sense of the term, we will have substantive democracy. In some cases, we are having that. Yesterday, I had been to Utkal University. A lady with three children had entered into the Utkal University campus. Police were holding them back. You cannot enter the campus. She said, I want some, you know, some plant products. That is why I have entered. You cannot restrict me. How will I eat? How will I live with my children? No, this is how the public is asserting its right to live. So if you try to look at positively to the way democracy is functioning, I would say institutionally we have procedural democracy, but substantive democracy is far off. But people are trying today because I showed to the learners how women have become 46.14% of people's representatives. And they say 100% is our, your is only 50%. If you go to the villages, you know, that is how the women, they said. Here also I would say one thing, how the women, they are understanding the process of election. One lady who was contesting the election, she had pen as her symbol, election symbol. Now I said, how did you campaign? You know what she said with me? She said, I bought some use and throw pens. And I gave one pen to the voters, to every household, and told them that this is my symbol. You must come and vote for me. And she won the election. So, and this is how we need to understand how the different social groups are asserting themselves to influence public policy. Now the silent protest of the migrant workers have compelled the government to think about them, to make arrangement for packages for them. This is their protest. Now this is how I understand this is the functional part of substantive democracy. Any other question?
Madam, the next Next question is, explain certain essential characteristics of local self-governance.
Essential features of local self-government.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Local government are field level organizations, administrative mechanisms. If you have local self-government, then there people rule themselves. People choose their representatives and they rule themselves. Now, if we have a federation, then you know, you need to have a local self-governance institution. Why? Because, you know, a federation believes in the area approach. They're all state governments are autonomous, are there, and they have their separate jurisdiction. They can have their independence so far as the state list is concerned, being within the constitution. Now, similarly, after the 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, though the state government has power to control the local bodies, but the local bodies are getting the power from the constitution. So today, local self-government is democratic in nature. In every 5 years, we are having election, maximum 5 years, 6 months. Beyond that, a local body cannot continue. Second is that we have 11th schedule and 12th schedule. 11th schedule enumerates the powers for the panchayats. 12th schedule enumerates the powers for the the urban local bodies. And every local body has certain financial powers, and if the state wants, they can empower them by just giving the power. See, just to handle the corona situation, to handle the quarantine centers, how, and to handle the migration issue, how the government has utilized the panchayat bodies as administrative mechanisms by empowering the panchayat. So it has functional autonomy in certain sense, it has administrative autonomy, and it is a political institution, it's a democratic institution. People can raise their voice. Finest example is Niyamgiri incident, where the Gram Sabha asserted its power and did not allow the government to extract minerals from the Niyamgiri mines. So this is the local self-governing institution. In nutshell, the features I told you. Any other question?
Dear learner, jodi apanmanankar kichhi question achi, apan apanka mic ko unmute kariki madam ko question pachari paranti. No, ma'am. No more questions. Thank you, ma'am. On behalf of the Odisha State Open University, I would like to thank you once again for your valuable time of our learners. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, our technical team. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, students. I think I am able to satisfy your queries. And I hope the lecture will be useful for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I also enjoyed the process.
disengage the platform. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, madam.
Welcome.